your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky. Sending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord of Paradise.
You're the reason.
Your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord,
show us your glory, Lord,
show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, God, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Hey, Lord, we thank you, God. Yes, Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak, strong in the same.
Through the storm, He
trust in His righteousness alone. Fall and stand before the throne. Fall and stand before the throne. Christ alone, my cornerstone. Weak, made strong in the Savior's love.
Days. We just thank you, God, you're with us when we're searching. Father God, when we don't know what's going on around us, you are there. We just thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet, my Savior on the cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid Him down and joy. Third.
sing that last verse again.
He shall return with drums of wine. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord our God. Hallelujah. We thank You tonight. We gaze upon You, Jesus.
Make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout out Your fame. Jesus is coming.
Wait, you're coming soon.
ready for you, God. We're getting ready for you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. We want to be the bride prepared. We want to be watching the signs of the times, Lord. God, watching the signs of you in our lives every day, God. We thank you, Lord.
The marriage of the Lamb, to come and worship Him, celebration, it's the joining of the bride and the son, the two becoming one, all the prophecies fulfilled, and in a moment. So we see, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of rolling thunder, hallelujah, give Him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb is come. Getting ready. Yes, we are. Filled with wonder as we behold the Lamb with fire in His eyes, the very Word of God. And you are worthy. Every kingdom, every nation bowing down. You with many crowns, and every creed and tribe and tongue declaring in unity, yes, Lord, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of rolling. Give Him glory.
we thank you, Lord. Have to do this one. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of the servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sore, so we are the voice in the desert, crying,
Father, tonight we thank you that you are omnipresent. You are Emmanuel. You are Sar Shalom, our Prince of Peace. You are our Messiah, our soon returning King. We thank you. We just give you the praise and the honor and the glory for who you are. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen, amen. Somebody next to you kind of needs just a little bump on the shoulder or a hug. Just kind of be sensitive to what people need and not oversensitive, you know what I mean. But you know what I mean. Just be so sensitive.
Oh, is there a switch
on? Nina, can you turn on Mike's mic?
Thank you.
It's on?
Probably a switch on.
There's a switch. A switch on.
Or the bottom.
Steps become harder. Well, thank you for worshiping with us tonight. Welcome to Blue Mountain Retreat and Conference Center. Would you show your appreciation for this worship team tonight? We have two more weeks of family weeks in the coming 2 weeks. So if you are here, see the office about arrangements to stay. If you are watching us live stream, you are welcome to tune in or, again, call the office and make arrangements to be here yourself during that time. There are really only two events going on after the service tonight. One is that the prayer chapel is open, of course, 24/7, so you want to make your way up there. Take a flashlight along. You can find your way up and back.
Got it, Beth.
The only other thing you can do is go to sleep and dream about eating Libby's ice cream. But that's it tonight. We'll just have a good night's sleep and prepare for tomorrow. I just want to say something about the book table back there. I don't know if Dr. Carl is going to mention it or not, but probably 15 or 20 years ago, I read his...
It's on. Sorry, Joe. It's on, Beth.
I read his book, A Proper Education. I feel that if the top 10 people in the education department of the United States would have read that book 10 or 15 years ago, our education system wouldn't be in the mess it is today. That is an excellent book. It applies to what's going on today. I would recommend that you seriously consider going on andybooks.com and ordering 10 of those for your church. The price is very reasonable, and you will bless your entire congregation if you do that. Something happened today. We had to skip out of the morning service. Our apologies for that. But we went over to Lehighton to help with a vacation Bible school. And it goes right along with the proper education. We were there as the kids came out and gave them pocket testaments, about 160 kids. And one little boy came out, and very small and sort of hesitant. And his grandmother said to him, "No, take it. I'll read it to you." That made the whole ministry worthwhile to hear that. And you know, that's where proper education starts. Mommy and daddy and grandma and grandpa reading the Word of God to their children. So it's so important. But I would encourage you to consider buying a whole bunch of copies of that book and sharing it with your church congregation. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. We want to take an offering tonight. Give you an opportunity to sow into the ministry of Blue Mountain Christian Retreat. This does not go for meals or rooms. This goes for our ministry speakers, for children's ministry, and to keep this place going. This place is a blessing to so many people, whether you're here, whether you're watching us online. It touches lives, and as Carl's ministry is to prepare the saints for ministry. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give into this work, to bless those who come here to minister, to bless the children, Lord, that are in the gym and going to activities right now. So, Father, we thank you for hearts that are open, for hands that are willing to give into this work, and we ask your blessings upon it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
Thank you, worship team. My wife will tell you that I don't miss this week for anything on the mountain. I need to be here this week to sit under these two gentlemen's teachings. Yesterday, though, we had to go to a funeral, so we missed the morning. 33-year-old Judy's great nephew's wife died in her sleep on July 1st, 33 years old. But it gave Judy an opportunity to comfort and talk with the grandmother of the girl and to speak into the life of one of her classmates. And today we were blessed going to the Vacation Bible School, but we're back. We're going to be here for the rest of the week. So we heard Dr. Carl many years ago and fell in love with his teachings. Even the one on tithing, remember the whole week on tithing? We got through that. It was great. It was good. Carl's primary purpose and call is to teach laymen and pastors to be more effective in their ministry. How many want to be more effective in their ministry? He's a pastor, a Hebrew scholar, teacher. And most of you here know this, but for you that are watching online, perhaps you've just tuned in tonight and you don't know anything about this place or who this gentleman is, so I want you to know who you're going to hear. He's president and chancellor of the Timothy Program International, a Bible curriculum currently being taught in more than 20 countries worldwide. We talked about a proper education, a Bible mandate for education, putting God back into our education system. An architect, a world-renowned basketball player. And as you saw last night, God's Land Journeys, which his ministry has put together over the last number of years. Would you give a warm Blue Mountain welcome to Dr. Carl Koch?
Testing, 1, 2. Testing, thank you, Lori. In 1960, I was 6 feet, 3 inches tall. I weighed 165 pounds, soaking wet. I was a member of a 12-player high school basketball team in Coos Bay, Oregon, center of the universe. Coos Bay is a little town on the southern coast of Oregon. The center on our team was drafted by Oregon State. I was an Oregon Duck. They wanted me to go with him because I had played throughout school. From grade school up with him, he was 7 feet, 1 inch tall. Needless to say, our little high school team never lost basketball games. My job was either to take the shot or give it to him. He averaged 35 points per game in high school, and I averaged 15. So going into every game, we already had 50 points. Now imagine this, in a little tiny town of 7,000 people, 9 of the 12 players could dunk the basketball. That's how tall we were. I was a guard, a point guard. In 1960, 6'3" was an unusual height for a guard, and we were all white. And we could jump. They always said white people can't jump. Yeah. So here's what we would do. This was our MO, no matter whether we were playing at home. Now, you have to understand, the town is 7,000 people. A high school basketball gymnasium seated 3,500 people. And we played to a capacity crowd every time. So we would wait till we heard the other team, our dressing rooms were below the basketball floor. We would wait till we heard them. And then our cue to come upstairs was a white, all-white band playing Sweet Georgia Brown. When I think about all of this, so then we'd come up the stairs. We'd come onto the court, and the other team had to watch all of this. That's why we waited till they were there. And the first nine of us would run up and dunk the basketball. I think we won more games before the tip-off just by intimidation. Any case, I forgot about all that. Here's two things that happen when you get 81. One, you've learned everything. Two, you forget everything. I just forgot to turn the microphone on. And yes, my wife did turn me on. You're under arrest, Edwin. I'm here to tell you that, what was the other thing, Joe, you said I was not only the world's best basketball player?
77 and I forgot.
Oh. Oh, you're, Joe and Judy have been friends a long time, and I love them, and their ministry was the Gideon Bibles. Distributing Gideon Bibles. I received a Gideon New Testament when I went to grammar school in 1948. Did anybody else get a little Bible when you went to public school? Am I the only one? Furthermore, every morning in public school began with not only the Pledge of Allegiance, but the reading of a scripture verse and prayer. I hope some of you remember those days. There are magazines back there. Remember, all of that is from Andy Books. Everything you donate goes to our orphanage in Andhra Pradesh, India. None of it goes to any of us. So your donations, please pick up the books. The magazine's called Restore. I was seated in my office one day when a good friend of mine, Dr. John David Garr, came into my office. He lives in Atlanta, Georgia. He had an idea of a magazine that would help Christians understand that Jesus is Jewish and that our roots are found in the Hebrew Scriptures. So Restore Magazine has articles written by a lot of scholars that will help you understand biblical passages. I write two articles for every magazine issued, one a lengthy article and one a short one page long on something Hebrew so that you can gain an understanding. But anyway, my articles are in those magazines if you wonder why they're there. There's only a few books left, so please don't hesitate to take what you want. Leave a small donation for the orphanage. Most of those books are written by very close friends of mine. One who is probably watching by, is this Zoom or Facebook or Internet or YouTube or, how many understand I don't understand a thing about electronics? Don't hand me your cell phone if it doesn't work, because when I'm done with it, you won't be able to fix it. But these authors are very close friends of mine. One of them, Jim Musto, who goes by the pseudonym of James Ben Frank, James, son of Frank. He wrote a book because of some of our Timothy program curriculum, which says when you pray, pray the Word of God. So he wrote this book that's fabulous for prisoners. I want to turn you on to that. If you have a prison ministry, you can leave that behind. And there are subjects alphabetized in there with scripture verses about what to pray about, because he learned the lesson. When you pray, pray God's word. This keeps you from selfishness and lust and asking for things that you want rather than what you need. So please, there's just a few copies of that back there if you'd like to take them. Excuse me? Somebody go back and get that book. I think it's... Here it is, Lori. Yeshua's Praying God's Word. James Ben Frank is James Musto. Anyway, I've inspired a lot of people to write worldwide. And the reason for it is, write the vision down. Make it clear. So I insist that my students, and I have a master's student in Reverend Ed Felici, he's working on his master's and he's writing his master's thesis right now. If you see him busy taking notes, he's not listening to my sermon. He's writing down notes for his thesis. My name is Coke, like you drink, C-O-K-E. Nothing funny about that until I earned a PhD. And so Dr. Coke makes people laugh worldwide. How many like Dr. Pepper? So Dr. Coke drinks Pepsi, because Coca-Cola doesn't pay me anything for all the free advertisement I give them. But I do appreciate the Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Atlanta, Georgia. Everywhere I fly in the world, I feel welcome. At every airport, there's a big billboard saying, Coke is it. So I feel like they're doing a good job for me. Now, I'm of the generation, and I want to see if anybody even knows about this. Ice cold Coca-Cola in a 7-ounce green bottle. Drink one swig and then fill it up with peanuts. Let me see who you are. What? Nobody has done that? You get sugar, salt, and fat. Just like that. Try it. It's a wonderful experience. Today I have to drink diet drinks. It's not near the jolt. I used to do 3 of them a day. And now I'm a diabetic. Now instead of 3 shots of Pepsi today, I take 3 shots of insulin every day. Now, you want to know how good God is? Let's just transition. I want to tell you how good God is. I have a very dear friend. He's my personal physician. I'd like to get him up to the camp some year. Bob and Helen, he would be a thrill. 26 years ago, this medical doctor had 4 days to live with terminal cancer. And he asked his local church to begin to videotape him for the record, not for healing, just for the record of his passing. And the photo or the film of him is so grotesque. His arms were small like my wrists. He had goiters and tumors the size of softballs sticking out of his neck and side. He was a mess, ready to go to glory, and his church started praying for him. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And he was dramatically healed. With 4 days to live, 26 years ago, the Lord healed him completely of terminal cancer. You can look him up on your internet. Take the time to write down Tom Renfro, R-E-N-F-R-O, video. Tom Renfro video. You can watch it on YouTube, Facts, WXYZ, BFD. What are all those names, Lori? What's it called? YouTube. Okay, thank you. Is anyone else handicapped when it comes to modern technology? Felix, just go ahead and raise your hand. Be honest about it. Are we the only two that are? Yeah, I just don't get some of the things that happen. But isn't it kind of wonderful to have the ability to get your cell phone and find your way to Blue Mountain? I'm still using maps. Young people, please, it's a piece of paper in color, and it has roads in Pennsylvania. And you kind of follow along with your finger and get lost in northern New Jersey. I wanted to go to Jackson, New Jersey, so I came all the way up 81 to 78, clear over to Port Amboy, Perth Amboy. And I was lost. I'm in northern New Jersey. Next thing I know, I'm on Rutgers campus. I have no idea where I am. So we called Juanita. Juanita, tell them what you told Lori. Please tell them. Just as be honest and brutal as you tell. Tell them what. Tell Carl to shut up and turn on your GPS. And sure enough, we got there just as quickly. I'm technically challenged. Tomorrow night, I'm going to put some booklets out there for you that you can order from Andy Books online. We're going to take a different approach. The sermon will come in a few moments. But I have friends in the state of New York that are here tonight. And we're going to pray tonight. And we're going to see God do a miracle. You just heard about Dr. Tom Renfro. How many believe that my God shall do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think possible? Edwin is going to lead the prayer, but to make sure that you don't think that he or I or anyone that is a guest here has special powers, I'm going to ask you, Felix, to join him. And I'm going to also ask a volunteer lady. I don't want it to appear to be that men have the gift or gifts of healing. Would you volunteer, because I would like to include someone who's not my color? Yes, ma'am. I want you to join me in a prayer in a moment. I'm teaching in Kumasi, Ghana. 800 Baptists. They've taken the time to get me a Ghanaian outfit. I'm dressed like an African. They're 5 feet 7 or shorter. I'm 6'3 or taller. I'm white, they're black. The service began, and I wondered, why am I 40 feet away from the pulpit? There was a dance floor between me and the pulpit. Well, it didn't take long. Up came the ladies, babies strapped to their back in papooses, and they commenced to dancing. When they were all done, the men came up. After the service was over, the chief said to me, Dr. Koch, you're white. Wow, how did you notice? He said, I watched you during praise and worship and during the dance. You cannot clap on 2 and 4. You clapped on 1 and 3, you're white. He had me. But tonight, Walter Hutchison has brought his son with him tonight. Walter and Chris are from Beacon, New York. I used to go there to preach at a former Assembly of God church where I met these lovely people. I had 2 sons, wanted to go into the ministry. They sent them to a Bible college university in Tennessee, and I found out that in the middle of their junior year of a Bible college, they had not taken 1 Bible class, not 1. So I rescued them from that school, and they started in the Timothy program, which is nothing but the Bible. The entire curriculum is the Word of God. And the reason why Edwin and Juanita know so much about the Timothy program is, please give them a round of applause. They translated every word I've ever written into Spanish. For that, they earned a bachelor's degree in biblical studies. Now the whole world that speaks Spanish has the Timothy program. Can you give God a praise offering for that? Spanish, español mío, muy, muy malo, muy lento en la cabeza. Soy feliz Cristo mi sábado. Amen. Amen. Anyway, I'm happy that Jesus is my Savior. Well, Lori and I have learned to speak New York. Just because these folks are from Beacon tonight, we want to honor them. And we're going to say Calfi is from the south. How do they say it up here, Lori? You learned how to say it. Quaffy, quaffy. How many like to drink quaffy? That's how they say it in Beacon, quaffy. I trained that young man sitting right there in the Word of God, and I want to introduce you to David Hutchison. Still, the highest ranking student in 1.5 million students worldwide, sitting right there. He was being groomed to go into the ministry, pastor, and he went on a mission trip. And he got a disease in his brain, encephalitis. They don't even know what the name of it is. But it has racked his speech and his physical body for 14 years. We're sitting with them at lunch today. And Edwin, tell them what happened. He was studying the Timothy program curriculum on a plane, headed to the mission field. Where? What country were you in? And shortly thereafter, he contracted this disease And we're going to lay hands on him tonight, anoint him with oil, and we're going to look for a miracle here tonight. If Dr. Tom Renfro can be cured, so can Dave. So Edwin, if you would please come with the anointing oil. Please, lady and gentlemen, and anyone else that feels led of God to come and gather around David, we're going to lay hands on him and believe what the scriptures say. If there is any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church and let them anoint with oil that the prayer of faith shall save the sick. How many would like to see David walk again, talk again, preach again? Let's all join in our prayers. Doctor, everybody lead us. Edwin, just speak out loud in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Every one of you that are praying, add this to your prayer. Write it down. His wife, same age. His sweet wife, Tony Ann, early 40s, is now being treated for brain cancer. Her teenage son is watching both his parents suffering. How many believe God is able to heal her as well? Can you say amen? We don't have to have her here. The scripture says the word of the Lord went forth and they were healed. The word of the Lord went forth and they were healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Folks, I want you to get excited tonight. How do I know that God can heal? I'm a miracle. Hallelujah. Last October, Dr. Tom Renfro came to our church to do a revival, and they prayed for my foot that you all know has bled nonstop for 15 years. One little prayer, just walking by me, my foot is not only not bled since October, it's completely healed. I don't know about God's divine selection. Jesus walked into the pool of Bethesda. There were many sick, and he healed one. I don't know why. It's locked somewhere in the wisdom and sovereignty of God. But I pray for everybody because I don't know who that next one is. Amen? Why do you pray? They're not healed because of our prayers. Why do you pray? Not because we get louder, softer, or whatever. How many believe the Lord our God healeth all our diseases? And Judy Imhoff shouted, I remember praying way back, Judy, for you, diagnosed with cancer, and here she sits today. Hallelujah! Thank you, all of you, for praying. Thank you, all of you. Don't stop. Do not stop. When we end this service, I want that song blasting. These are the days of Elijah. Are you ready? Because we're headed back there. Thank you for your song selection and praise and worship tonight. I have good news to tell all of you that have been a big part, the video series, all 52 episodes of God's Land Journey are complete, paid for, and up on the internet. So if you want to go to Israel for $99.99 and not go over there in an airplane, sitting in the comfort of your own home, you can just sign up for this. It's easy to do. Lori can help you follow the instructions back on the table. I'm going to just sit down and let you praise God a little bit because here's who we are. We are thankful people. Here's the confidence that we have. When we pray, he hears us. Shout amen. And since he hears us, we have the petition we sought. So we're not going to be unthankful. I'm just going to let it start, and I don't care how long it lasts or how loud you get. But would you please thank the Lord for Dave, Tony Ann, for mine, for Judy, for everybody in this place that's been healed by the Lord. Give God a praise offering. Felix, would you stand and lead us in a praise offering to the Lord, thanking him for all his goodness. Amen. Amen. Tonight, the subject is the second time. As you witnessed in the videotape last night, my friend Michael Melchior, the rabbi, member of the Knesset, saying that it was not by chance that he's been called by God from Denmark, his home nation, to live in Israel, to bring peace between Jews and Arabs, Jews and Muslims, that he said it was prophetic. Tonight we're talking about the second coming. The songs have been about the second coming. We're talking about the fulfillment of prophecy. We're talking about those mentioned in the book of Philippians that wag their tongues at us, mocking us, and saying, "Where is his coming?" You keep saying it. How many are confident the word of God is true when he says God is not slack concerning his promises? How many believe that he said it? It's going to happen. Jesus is coming, and I believe in my lifetime. And it won't matter either way whether I'm here when he comes or I meet you in the air. I'm telling you, this is the generation that is the welcoming committee to the Lord Jesus Christ. But without doubt, the biggest difficulty between Jews and Christians is that Jesus is God's Messiah. That's a problem. Jews don't recognize him, though he came 2,000 years ago as a baby in Bethlehem, born to the Virgin Miriam. We call her Mary. Furthermore, I believe that Jesus is the only Messiah. The Jews are trying to get around this by saying, you Gentiles got a Messiah and we Jews have one. The Jews call our Messiah Mashiach ben Joseph. They call their Messiah Mashiach and David, and David. I love to take tours to Israel, and some of you have been there with me. And when we used to go in the early 70s, the mayor of Jerusalem, Mayor Teddy Kollek, used to meet with the groups, especially those groups that I was part of. And he would come aboard the bus. Can you imagine what I'm saying? A political figure, the mayor of Jerusalem, coming aboard a bus without any bodyguards. And he would get on the bus, and you have to watch now, don't fall asleep. You have to stay awake for this one. Mayor Teddy Kollek would get the microphone and say to the tourists, "I have the best job on earth. I get to prepare the city of Jerusalem for the coming of Messiah." Then he'd do this. Some for the first time. Then he would wink. Then he would say, "Some for the second time." How many know that politics play both sides of every fence? Forgive me for saying this. How do you know politicians are lying? Their lips are moving. But the coming of Jesus is not a winking matter. And I want to spend a short time with you tonight giving you a text they cannot weasel out. Our text tonight is Isaiah chapter 11. Verses 10 through 13. It reads, "And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign, that's Old English, or flag or sign, of the people, of the Jews. This root of Jesse will stand as a sign to the Jews, but to it, the sign, shall the Gentiles seek. He came the first time for his own, but his own received him not. The Jews rejected him the first time he came. But how many are grateful that John says, but to as many as have received him, to them gave he power to become the sons and daughters of God. Can you shout hallelujah? Hallelujah. Then it says something so seemingly unnecessary. And his rest shall be glorious. Why is that stuck in there? That's stuck in there to let you know there's a time period between his first coming and his second coming. And that is here called a rest. He's resting. He's seated at the right hand of God the Father. And during the period between his first and second coming, the events of his rest on earth will be glorious. Now, if you don't shout amen tonight, I'm going to ask for two or three volunteers to stand up and whoop, 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 and do a jersey shout. But I'm telling you, you're part of the glory that occurred between his first and second coming. His rest allowed you to become saved, born again, born of the Spirit. Now how do you feel about it? It is glorious. Then look at verse 11. And it shall come to pass. I want you to break that down into modern English. Just say it with me. Later. And it shall come to pass simply means later, in that day, later in that day, this is the day of the automobile, not July 12th. That's not, it's the day, it's the epic, it's the time of the automobile. When I was young, children, I had to walk to school uphill both ways in the snow. Are they buying any of this? The day doesn't mean a single day. In that day, between his coming the first time and the second time, is called the day of the Lord. In that day, listen to these words, the Lord shall set his hand again the second time. This is undeniable proof that the same Lord who came as a sign to the Jews and the Gentiles followed him will set his hand again the second time. How many understand what I'm saying is you can't fudge here. The same Lord who came the first time will set his hand again the second time. And what's his purpose in the second time? To recover the remnant of his people, the Jews. That's why he's coming back again, to recover the Jews. And in that day, since 1918, folks, listen, the Jews have all heard something inside themselves come home. And they've been going home for the last 100 plus years. He's recovering his people. The ones that shall be left, in Hebrew, the ones that he deliberately left behind. The ones that he, the first time, deliberately left behind, who had faith in him, from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, Elam, Shinar, Hamath, and actually it says America, Australia, Great Britain, South America, Central America. Yes, indeed, even the Philippines. Come on, let's hear you. From the islands of the sea, lands that are surrounded by water. Hallelujah. Look at verse 12. This time, he's coming as a sign, a flag, ensign in King James, for the Gentiles. Who did he come for the first time? The Jews. They rejected him. Who accepted him the first time? The Gentiles. So he's coming now as a sign to us. And if you want to get a bunch of books that are a bunch of nonsense, you can go to any religious bookstore and buy all kinds of books written by people who have no idea what they're writing about, talking about the signs of the coming of Jesus. I won't mention his name, but there was an author that I used to appear on PTL with who wrote a book, sold thousands of copies, that the Jews had started a zoo in Jerusalem. And they were replenishing all of the animals mentioned in the Bible. And because the prophecy says that the vultures will take a long time to clean up the dead from Armageddon, this guy wrote a fictitious chapter that every vulture egg in the zoo had 7 or 8 or 10 or 12 chicks in every egg. Absolutely untrue. But people in the West, Gentiles, hungry for signs of the coming of the Lord. I hope you don't have that book on your shelf. But instead of the Gentiles accepting him, who's going to accept him according to this passage when he comes the second time? He shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Now, before you get excited and go out and think that the earth is flat, four corners is a metaphor explaining to you east, north, west, and south. Those of you that are nervous about the earth being flat, the North Pole is not the center of the earth. There's not a big ice ring around the edge to keep you from falling off. I'm sorry to announce that to you. Some other people wrote a book. Four corners of the earth. Where will the Jews come from? The north, the south, the east, and the west. Metaphorically, the corners of the earth. Wait a minute. You came for the Jews and the Gentiles believed in you. So now the second time you're coming for the Gentiles and the Jews are going to accept you. You better get excited. This thing begins to build because verse 13 talks about a time after Christ is here on earth where the enmity, the vexation, the hatred will leave between Jew and Gentile. We will be one new man. Just like Ephesians chapter 2 says, we who were Gentiles, aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, without hope in the world, get ready to shout. But through Christ and his blood, we've been brought nigh and been made fellow partakers of the inheritance. Can you shout it, amen? We are grafted into the family of God by the blood of Jesus Christ. And why? Because to develop the one new man. Who is the one new man? Say it properly. The one man renewed. Who's the man that fell? His name is Adam. Why is Jesus making of the two one man renewed? Because for 1,000 years, Lori is going to garden. Bob's going, 1,000 years of pom-poms? Brother Tom, you get to play pickleball for 1,000 years. Because the envy and the vexation will depart. So this passage not only is his first coming and his second coming, it talks about how it will be when he returns again. Anybody looking forward to Satan being in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years? Anybody interested in Jesus Christ ruling and reigning from Mount Zion in Jerusalem? Anybody interested that the whole law of the whole world will be to follow the word of God? Is anyone interested in this? I certainly am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many think this is a very key passage of Scripture? Would you agree? They weaseled out of Isaiah 53 and other passages, but they cannot escape this passage. Now, these are the days of Elijah. Are you kind of getting... There's an Andy Griffith episode where it's Ernest T. They clean him up. And he goes to this house to be a part of the dance, and he's going to go dance. So on the way over there, you watch Ernest T. begin to get the rhythm and begin. Are you getting, Ernest T., excuse me, are you getting the rhythm? These are the days of, I don't know, the gospel according to Andy Griffith. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, verse 9, what do we learn? The things that have been is that which shall be. That which is done now is that which is shall be done. Ecclesiastes 3, 14 and 15. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been. Why? God requires the past. Let me put it to you. God fulfills prophecy. What has happened will happen. How many have been listening? How many times has the Messiah come? Twice. When will the Jews accept him? So if that's ever happened before in the Bible, then it's fixin'. Do you like that? That's a southern phrase. It's fixin' to happen again. Excuse me, Lori, for being blasphemous. The first time this happened, when Jews accepted the word of God, the second time is the story of Joseph. Say it out loudly with me. Joseph is Jewish. He was sold by his brothers into slavery. His brothers had a hand in his apparent death because they took the bloody robe home to show Dad he'd died. But how many are grateful for Judah? That guy in Egypt asked us to come back again, but he wants the youngest son. He wants this baby boy, the dad's favorite, the 12th born. And if he doesn't release him, I will sacrifice myself. Judah. How many think that a Jewish Messiah is pretty clear? So when his Jewish brothers got down to Egypt during the famine and they met this Arab dressed like an Arab, not speaking Hebrew, the last time they had seen him was a teenager and now he's in his 30s. They have no idea who he is. The first time they go down to get food, the first time they go down to get saved, the first time they get down there for the Messiah, Joseph, to save them, they don't recognize him as a Jew. Is anybody beginning to suspect something? How many know they got hungry a second time? And the second time they went back, please prepare to shout tonight. These are the days of the Lord's return when they went the second time. The Messiah himself couldn't take it anymore because he knew all along who they were. He even sat them at the table according to their ages. And with one shout, Achim! Achim Shali! My brothers. Ani Yosef. I am. And he cleared the room of all the Gentiles to make this announcement. I don't know if you ever think about things, but here you have the clearing of a room to make room for nothing but Jews to recognize that the same Messiah they didn't recognize the first time is indeed their brother. And now they get nervous. Oh, man. We told your father you died. You're going to beat us up. You're going to punish us. He said, no, listen to what the Messiah said. No. It was God who sent me. It was God who sent me to save the Gentiles and now the Jews. There's no revenge for the cross. There's no revenge for those who tried him. There's no revenge for any of that. How many know that Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane said, Father, let this cup pass from me. Then he said, nevertheless, thy will be done, not mine. So he embraced the death, burial, and resurrection that both Jew and Gentile could be saved. Hallelujah. In the mouth of two or three witnesses, truth is established. What's the other witness? Moses. Get ready. You got the rhythm going? You got the guitar and the drums? Does anybody even know who Ernest T. Bass was? He only appeared in 7 episodes, but you'd think he was in every one of them. His very, very big claim to fame was throwing rocks through the window. It's me, it's me. Moses is the type of the Messiah. Moses went up to Mount Sinai to bring the word of God down from heaven. And everybody said, wow, that's cool. He went up to bring Jesus, the word of God, down from heaven. And when he got down, there the Jews were celebrating around the golden calf. Folks, I have news for you. at Brother Aaron, listen to his explanation of how the golden calf appeared. Brother, I don't know. All of the people gave me their earrings, including the boys. That always bothered me, but anyway, it's in the scripture. And I just threw the gold into the fire and out popped this golden calf. Let's all say, really? You want me to buy that? So there's this little five-year-old, 913 South First Street, Coos Bay, Oregon, gravel driveway. I'm Carl Koch, the five-year-old. And I saw a glass in the garage door, and I picked up a rock and threw it and broke the glass. The sound brought my father out. Gene Koch said, did you do this? Now, I only have seconds to come up with a five-year-old explanation. So I said, Dad, no, I didn't do it. It was amazing. I was just standing here, and a rock flew up out of the driveway and broke that window. Now, I got whipped until there was no tomorrow. Not for breaking the window. Who knows why I got whipped? Oh, I learned real quickly. I just threw this gold into the fire, and out jumped this golden calf. So what happened? Moses turned and went back up to the mountain. And it says that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, wrote the commandments with his own finger. How many believe this is the word of God, not some man-made myth? This is the word of God. He wrote it with his own finger. And he came down a second time. And that's when the Jews married. We were singing about the wedding supper. That's when the Jews married Jehovah at the huppah in the Sinai. When do the Jews accept him? Second time. What are we waiting for? We're going to have fun now. Come on, let's get up here and start the band. Wind it up, gang. We want ukuleles, guitars, drums. Violins. Joe, did you bring your trumpet? You left it at home? Joe, did you bring your trumpet? Do you have one? No. We need some banners, so please find something up there that's going to excite this crowd about the second coming of the Lord. When do Jews accept Jesus? That's what's about to happen. Jesus said, I'm coming as a sign to the Gentiles, but it's then that the Jews will find me. We're going to celebrate now. These are the days. Stand with me and sing it. Here we go.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, the righteous. Serpent.
Now, before we sing it through again, both Elijah and Moses, notice the scriptures tonight. I want you to shout with the disciple whom Jesus loved and who loved Jesus, John. Because I believe all of you love Jesus. And I know for sure he loves you. And here's what John shouted. Even so, Lord, come quickly. Are you ready? One, two, three.
Come quickly.
Again.
Come quickly. Lord, come quickly.
The deeds of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses. Benediction will be you greeting one another and learn how to say it. I'll meet you here tomorrow or in the air. God bless you. God bless you all.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
bless you guys. Have a good night. We'll see you.